Do you have a statin prescribing doctor? Well, most of us do. In reality, there's no getting around it. Statin prescribing is here to stay, but that doesn't mean we have to participate in it. In this series, I'm going to go over 12 things that I wish every statin prescribing doctor would do. Part one, we'll go over the first six. Stay tuned. If your doctor is using a risk calculation to tell you what your 10-year risk is, they ought to at least use the most accurate one out there, and that's the 2018 pooled cohort equation based risk calculator. Or if you have a coronary artery calcium score, you can use the MESA calculator. There'll be links to each of these in the description here. The problem is most doctors are using the older 2013 pooled cohort equation risk calculator because that's what the American Heart Association and American College of Cardiology sites give for their calculations. And these are known to be extremely high, 87% on average too high. So what does that do? Well, it overstates your risk. Well, what would be the advantage of overstating your risk? Makes it more likely that you're going to be prescribed statins. I always wonder, why is it that the American Heart Association still has that calculator up there instead of the more accurate one? And you can't tell by looking at the inputs which it is. You have to do a little research. If you use the 2018 pooled cohort equation, it's far more accurate and for most of us gives a far lower score. And if you do have a coronary artery calcium score, you can use this MESA calculator. And again, I find it interesting that the 2018 calculator is available on the Merck website. That is a pharmaceutical company. If any organization had a reason to overstate your risk, it would be a pharmaceutical company. Yet they're given the more accurate one, and the American Heart Association uses the less accurate one that overstates risk. You decide. Doctors should tell patients their absolute risk reduction that they would get from taking statins. Most studies show a relative risk reduction, like in this famous Lipitor ad, somewhere between 25% and 40%, this one was 36%. But you'll notice that the absolute risk reduction for that group was only 1.1%. The problem with just using that 1.1% value is that the absolute risk reduction that you'll get actually depends on what your absolute risk is. You can't just say it's a 1% reduction of risk. If you're in a population of people with a 3% risk, then it'll knock it down to 2, so that is a 1% reduction. But to get a ballpark estimate of your absolute risk reduction, you just simply multiply the relative risk reduction from the product, we'll say 36% for Lipitor, times your absolute risk. Now, that is an extrapolation. It hasn't been shown that this relative risk reduction of 36% applies across all risk levels. But for most of us that are faced with a primary prevention decision to make, it's probably pretty close. So for example, if your risk of a heart attack in the next 10 years was 11%, then your absolute risk reduction would be about 4%. For people minimally eligible, that's what they use, the term they use, for statins, that would be an absolute risk of about 7.5%. If we apply this 36% relative risk reduction to it, then it's still very small, and that's the point. So when people insist the absolute risk reduction is 1.1% or 1%, no, that's not true in all cases, but to their credit, it is very small. It's much smaller than the 36%. In theory, you would have to have 100% chance of a heart attack in the next 10 years to get a 36% reduction, and I have a video on this. This is often misquoted. This whole absolute risk reduction versus relative risk reduction thing, both sides get it wrong. And watch this video here up in the corner if you want to get the real story on it. Doctors should accept that adverse effects are real. Trotting out the nocebo effect, that should not be their first thought. They're real, but due to the nocebo effect, having that in the back of their mind, that's hubristic. And that's really degrading to your patients if you're thinking that way. And it's really disrespecting them. That's not any better. Saying, well, yeah, they're real, but they're all nocebo effect. Not the case. Yeah, there is such a thing as a nocebo effect. It does exist, but it's far less prevalent than we'd be led to believe. Headlines such as we saw, Samson trial, 90% of statin complaints are nocebo effect. That grossly mischaracterizes what the data actually shows. And again, I did a video on that one. The burden really shouldn't be on the patient to prove beyond all doubt that they're having adverse effects. Hey, docs, your patients spend 8,766 hours a year dealing with the adverse effects from statins. You give them a 20-minute extended visit 3 times a year, adds up to an hour? Well, when you're doing that, keep that ratio in mind that they're experiencing this for nearly 9,000 hours for every hour you're giving them. If your first thought is to blow off adverse effects, this nocebo effect, then you really need to return to medical school and take some courses on basics in prescribing medicine. Work on high blood pressure, smoking, and insulin resistance first. Here's the factors that are weighted the most by the risk calculators. Smoking, somebody's a smoker, that will increase their risk. Whether they have type 2 diabetes, which is basically insulin resistance to the extreme degree, and hypertension or high blood pressure. You work on those things first and you're gonna reduce risk a lot more than any theoretical reduction you might get from somebody with high cholesterol. And that's a whole nother topic, and I know a lot of viewers don't even think that that's a problem. Well, according to the risk calculators, it's way down there on the list. You'll do a lot more by reducing your blood pressure to the point where even though I have what might be considered high cholesterol in some camps, my risk is now under that 7.5% eligibility criteria. Here's an important one. Please stop the statin worship. I put together a video on the 5 worst statin ideas, and you can get to it by way of this link. They shouldn't be sold over the counter. I believe low dose ones are sold over the counter in the UK, and that's just a bad idea because now you got people taking a dangerous drug with minimal controls. They shouldn't be given to very many children. If your child has familial hypercholesterolemia or FH, especially if it's homozygous, you may have to consider this because while it may ruin their lifestyle, if you're dead, you don't have much of a lifestyle, and people with homozygous FH do have shortened lifespans. They shouldn't be given to everyone over 50 or 40 or 60 or whatever age that you pick. That's just absurd. I mean, that's saying nobody of this age group can possibly be healthy enough to not need this artificial drug in their systems. They shouldn't be served as condiments. Now, granted, that was an idea that was floated out there for about 10 microseconds about 10 or 15 years ago, and the medical community rejected it, but it actually made its way into some journals that that would be something where you could give it as a condiment at McDonald's, so when you have your fries, you could take a statin with it, and that was somehow gonna counteract the badness that you'd get from the french fries. And they shouldn't be in the water supply, and a lot of doctors use that, oh, I think it should be in the water supply. It's a shorthand for saying everybody should be on it, and obviously, for a lot of reasons. Just watch my series on that. But they've got to stop this statin worship. Start paying more than just lip service to therapeutic lifestyle changes. For a motivated patient, diet, exercise, stress reduction, and smoking cessation will benefit more than statins possibly could. You've got to recognize the validity of cholesterol quality over cholesterol quantity. In other words, just treating a number. That's what was happening to me when I first went on statins. I'll do a video about that in the future. Understand triglycerides over HDL ratio. Understand oxidized LDL and LDL fractionation and what LP little a means, what APOB means, and all these things that are better quality indicators that can really say, no, in this person, the higher cholesterol is not a problem. Don't stop at the first lifestyle change if it doesn't give immediate results. Lifestyle changes take a while. They need to be holistic. They need to be tailored to the individual. The one-size thinking, you gave a lifestyle change to the patient, said, go on a low-fat diet. They're on a low-fat diet. That means they're on probably a high-carbohydrate diet. Their HbA1c goes up, their health is deteriorating. Maybe you just gave them the wrong lifestyle. So don't just say, oh, we tried lifestyle changes and they came back a month later and there was no improvement, so here, take this drug. That's just no way to run a medical practice. So that's what I've got on this topic. The fact is, no doctors are gonna be watching this video. So you as a patient, if you understand what your expectations should be of your doctor, as I've outlined in this series, you can at least kind of get a good feel for whether your doctor's gonna play fair with you or not. So if you appreciate this content, please like, share, subscribe, and comment on this topic or any others you'd like me to cover. Thanks for listening.